You're listening to the ESO Network, your station for all things geek.
Welcome to Myopia Defend Your Childhood. This week we're talking Breakfast Club as part of what was week two and is still week two. Hey, of Public Defender Month. Hey guys, appropriately enough, I have to wake up early tomorrow to go extra early to school as a teacher. So I guess, yeah, woo. Anyway, I hope everything's going well with you guys. We're finally getting all this Public Defender stuff together. And then, of course, next month is the last month of the season. If you're listening to this the day it drops, we have a Cineprov show, but not the night it drops, the Saturday it drops, okay? And we're doing Fantastic Four. I'm not on it, but I will be there to chill out with all of you in the audience and, ooh, stomach it again. Gross. Also, thanks for rating, reviewing, sharing, Twitter, Facebook, Letterboxd, which I'm really into because it's just talking movies, man. No stupid uncles sharing stupid, mildly racist memes. It's the best. Anyway, also, everything is great, and I'm about to be done with a whole bunch of stress and busyness for this next couple months, so enjoy as I also feel more relaxed in the future. Thanks, guys.
Dragons do not do well in captivity.
How do you know this?
That's what I do. I
podcast.
And I know things.
Hi, I'm Robin Paris from The Room, and you're listening to We Podcast and We Know Things.
Hello, this is Grant Kirkhope. I'm famous for saying Ubinaka and Ikabokum. And you're listening to We Podcast and We Know Things.
It's more than Nick, okay, man. You're listening to Greg and Sam on the We Podcast and We Know Things, y'all.
Welcome to Miami Defend Your Childhood. This week we're on week two of our Public Defender Month, and this week we have been requested the Breakfast Club from Warren. It says, "Hi Warren, this is Warren. I'm calling to say that I would like you to defend the Breakfast Club. Please let us do the Breakfast Club. It's one of my all-time movies. It's amazing. I think it'd be a great one for you to do. I'm leaving my request. Thank you so much for everything. Bye." And it sounds like Warren knows this well, because every time it says "you should," it says "us" or "we," because Warren apparently knows what Warren is doing.
What? Why do you keep looking at me? Why do you keep looking at me, Nick?
Because you're directly across from me, Warren. I mean, Warren.
I think we should buy Warren a beer. Do you think we should buy Warren a beer?
I don't know. I think like Warren's been drinking for a while.
Would have gotten away with it, too, if it wasn't for you meddling kids. Oh, so you're telling me I got caught. Fine, I admit it. It was me. I requested this movie.
Yeah, we'll see. So we'll see if Breakfast Club holds up due to rough oral sex in the middle of it. I'm a Nick Hoffman, host of Myopia Defend Your Childhood, and my childhood's been rocked right now. And on panel we got...
Hello, this is Daniel, and I didn't have anything better to do on a Saturday either.
This is Adam.
This is Lauren, and don't you forget about me. Hey, 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 hey.
Pump's fist.
Yeah.
Pump my fist in the air.
Freeze frame.
I had to do it.
Hey, are we not doing phrasing anymore?
Yeah. Well, here's the thing about this movie. Well, actually, before we get, I guess, too far along, Adam, you want to give us a plot synopsis?
Sure. It's pretty simple. A group of, I believe, five high school students are sent to a Saturday detention in the library. Let the hijinks ensue. They all embody the different high school archetypes. You got the jock, you got the princess, who's got daddy's credit card, you got the geek, you got the basket case, and you got the... The
school
criminal.
To prison.
He calls himself
the school to prison pipeline victim.
Delinquent type, and they're all put in a room together. So basically, all the different high school archetypes thrown in a room together for a few hours. Let's see what happens.
Oh, and the principal is the chief from Die Hard.
And the principal is the
Dick from Die Hard, and he's probably the most evil, sadistic principal I've ever seen in a movie, maybe next to Rooney.
Well, and I mean, this movie is, I don't want to say it's not a movie. It's a bottle. It's like a bottle episode of a TV show, because you're thrown in as though we know these characters, which I think is part of the success of the movie. Like, this is not an insult. It's just these people. Like, of course he's the jock. And I mean, casting aside, it's a cartoon character that is Emilio Estevez being the jock. This is a 1980. Lauren, you might be taller than Emilio Estevez and definitely more imposing.
Oh, boy.
I just want to say, you guys, before we even get started, y'all know this is my favorite movie. Like, this is my movie. Something about it, I don't know, just speaks to my soul. Me, I think it goes back to me and my sister used to watch this all the time. I can quote it all the time. So just be gentle with me with this movie because I love it so much. But Emilio Estevez was actually, fun fact, you're saying he doesn't look like a jock. Well, he was actually supposed to be cast as John Bender. He was originally supposed to be, yeah, and John Hughes, and John Hughes couldn't find anyone right for the Andrew role, for the Jack role.
Uh-huh.
So that's how he finally got Judd, right? Can you imagine Emilio as John Bender?
Can you imagine him looking up at Molly Ringwald and saying, "Hey, you, I'm sexually going to aggress against you." We're an all hour.
He would have just done what he did in Repo Man. It would have been the same character.
Yeah. I mean, I like Emilio Estevez. He might have the greatest death scene ever in Mission Impossible, where the elevator stabs him to death.
And do you know who was supposed to play, speaking of weird different casting, who was supposed to play the janitor?
Ron Jeremy.
Rick Moranis.
What? That would have been awesome.
Better
he
movie.
Was supposed to be cast. They went away versus creative differences between him and John Hughes. So I don't know what went down, but he was originally cast.
I will say the idea of Rick Moranis cracking beers with that creepo principal is kind of the best.
Is this not the most evil principal in history who should have been arrested like several times over?
Because he's beating the shit out of kids?
Well, the thing is,
power hungry.
Instead of staying professional, he took everything super personal. Like, all of his personal beliefs came out and he like unleashed it on these high school students.
I mean, he gives a Joker speech halfway through.
Yes, you know. Isn't there a scene where he corners Bender into a room and he's like, "You're fucking dead," or something.
Yeah.
"You're dead," yeah.
And he's like, "You know, I'm not a principal in here." And it's like a mob scene. It's like where the cop takes off his badge.
And it's so crazy that even Bender, the craziest character in the movie, is just sitting there looking at the principal like, "What?"
He's like, "What? You threatening me?" Yeah.
What is going on right now?
But my argument, Nick, is you're saying that you're supposed to go into them already knowing them. Well, the dialogue, I feel, is what makes you learn about them as you go along. This dialogue in this movie is amazing.
Well, I mean, I'm going to agree with you. It is. Yeah. I'm not going to argue with you there. Yeah. I'm going to argue with you because Hughes wrote a good script.
Right.
And he's saying that you know these archetypes, so I don't need to explain them, which is a strength. I'm not saying it's a negative.
Yeah.
I'm just saying.
Well, it's a very unique and interesting concept. Like, we always knew about the high school archetypes, but throw them into a room for a few hours and see what happens. It's a cool concept.
But the dialogue is how you get into the character
I guess. Well, except most of the dialogue was improvised, like that scene where they're talking about Christmas at Bender. Yeah, that's all improv.
That's what I
love
like
that.
It. That's one of my favorite things about this movie is the dialogue is so natural and improvised, and it seems like they're actually just there's no acting.
Yeah, and there must have been days worth of film shot. I love that.
Yeah. Well,
they actually rehearsed this movie as a play. Which is how it reads out to me.
It feels
that's how they rehearse it. Wouldn't it make a great state? Thank you, starring Adam and Lauren. Anyway.
Well,
I call
Claire.
I don't know. Your hair's combed-ish?
I'll be Emilio Estevez.
I'll be the janitor. Can I be the janitor?
Yes, you can.
All right. I'll be a bookshelf.
You be the power-hungry. You be the power-hungry principal,
high school,
Nick.
I was
done.
Anthony Michael Hall, so I don't want
to
play that character.
So. I mean,
but they rehearsed
to be fair,
it.
Most of the drama kids I knew were kind of Anthony Michael.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, they were somewhere between Anthony Michael Hall and Ally Sheedy.
Ally Sheedy makes a sandwich out of Captain Crunch, which we'll get to.
Which is delicious looking.
I would actually eat the hell out of that sandwich. And then she uses her dandruff for snowflakes, and I would also do that too.
Yeah, but they actually rehearsed it as a play.
Okay. It's like a Marx Brothers bit.
I guess
bit.
John Hughes wanted it more authentic and more natural, I guess.
So originally the movie was supposed to be 2.5 hours long. And it's now like 97 minutes, so they cut like more than an hour of stuff out. Well,
you said the Criterion.
No, not quite an hour, but oh yeah, this was released on Criterion, and when they put it out on Criterion, all the Criterion fans were going nuts.
Oh,
the opposite. It's like, why the hell would this be in the Criterion collection? Yeah. This is a terrible choice.
It's a weird choice. I don't disagree with it, though. I like the idea because it's Americana.
Yeah. It is one of the most mainstream movies that they selected for Criterion. I will say that, but that not really
good. Armageddon is Criterion, so.
Oh, yeah. Well, they have the Beastie Boys' music videos.
They do.
Criterion, so.
They're better than some things. Weird Al should get a Criterion release for his music video.
Oh, for music videos.
Both. Do it a box
Jeff.
Set.
Wait, Jeff. Yeah.
The Weird Al collection.
Did anyone else realize that John Hughes has a cameo in this film?
Yes.
Yeah, he's the dad.
He is Brian's dad at the end that picks him up.
So,
an important question for you, Lauren. Does Barry Manilow know that you raid his wardrobe?
I mean, it's...
Is there a ruckus? I heard a ruckus.
I mean...
Can you describe the ruckus, man?
So you also know that Bender is the source of the name Bender from Futurama, right?
Yeah, Bender...
I was wondering that.
No.
Bender that I...
No.
What's his last name, too?
Bender Bending Rodriguez.
No, the character in the movie.
John Bender.
John Bender.
Yeah, but that was the motivation.
Oh, my God.
No.
Did not know that. You blew my mind.
Well, and there's a lot about this movie we can get into. It's a weird chamber drama. I think the reason why it'd be more interesting as a stage play if it was improv'd the whole way. You set up the characters, you set them in the room, but the rest can just be gone, right?
Oh, well, at that point, it's like the play from La La Land where only 10 people show up to see it and it's all monologues.
No. People would show up because La La Land is terrible and this is a movie.
Don't say that.
It kind of is.
Here's the thing about La La Land. It's filled with white people and it's forgettable.
A lot of movies
are like that, my friend. Yeah.
Guess what? And like the rest of them, it's mostly forgotten. I got ASMR there at the end, so ladies, you're welcome. I mean, I thought it was fine. I enjoyed it when I watched it. I don't necessarily have an urge to rewatch it. La La Land. This movie I loved.
I'll rewatch the hell out of Breakfast Club.
Do it tomorrow.
I gotta devote a small segment here to Judd Nelson.
Preach.
Talk about Judd Nelson.
Preach.
Judd Nelson, and I've always been surprised that Judd Nelson never went on to become an A-list actor because he gives a scene-stealing...
Every scene he's
he
in.
He drives the movie, to be quite honest. He's so great. The scene where he's playing basketball, I gotta get me a scholarship.
Trying for a scholarship. Don't you want to know my excuse?
Don't you want to know my
trying
excuse?
Out for
he's so great. He steals the whole movie, but for some reason, he never went on to do anything significant after this movie.
Does he wear two different types of shoes and leave one of them behind in the gym?
I think
he
does.
Shows back up later.
But Judd Nelson was just phenomenal in this movie.
Completely.
I will give you one thing here. I was a film person for a while. This might be the best evidence for auteur theory of film, in that the director is the magician who makes it all work, because none of these people did much other than John Hughes movies.
80s teen movies, yeah.
Because, like, I mean, I like Molly Ringwald, but I realize I only like her for these movies.
These three movies.
Judd Nelson, Emilio Estevez, Anthony Michael Hall,
Edward Scissorhands.
Edward Scissorhands, maybe 6 Degrees of Separation, but he didn't do a whole lot after.
But John Hughes made these people. And so I guess it's the director, which is weird to say because I don't like the auteur theory, but he stole the show here. Like,
yeah, he did.
The only thing I will say is...
One of my favorite performances in movies, actually.
I mean, what I will say is this movie is interesting because it's written starring Gen Xers, but clearly written by a baby boomer. And nothing is more clear about that than the weed scene, because that's a scene that was written by someone who was in high school in the 60s.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
They're like, it's in my locker, man. Because the idea that a school administrator wouldn't walk into the library and say, this smells like weed, is a cartoon, man. Because they're just smoking it up in a loft somewhere in a giant high school library.
Well, here's the thing about John Hughes for me. I wasn't of age to see these movies back in the day, or did I even exist back in the day? Probably not. But when I saw these as a kid, it's like, oh yeah, that's what it's going to be like when you're a teenager and everything's going to make sense. And that is bullshit.
Here's the thing. John Hughes I love because, like I said earlier with Lauren, he's one of the few directors who could successfully convey what a teenager was thinking.
Yes.
What I liked about it is all of the teenage actors said behind the scenes, like, this is the first director we ever worked with that treated us as equals.
They mm-hmm.
talked down to us like we were kids. Mm-hmm. And I love that. John Hughes understood the teenage mind. Yeah, he was a little, there was times where his 60s teen mind kind of seeped in there. But I would say, I can't think of any other directors who made teen movies as successful as he did.
And I think they're trying to make that clear by the very first freaking scene when it's the quote of David Bowie.
Oh,
when,
from Changes.
And these children, yeah, these children that you spit on as they try to change the world are immune to your consultations. They are quite aware of what they're going through. David Bowie. I think he was trying.
Changes.
I think he's trying to show that they have a voice. They know what's going on. They're not.
Teenagers are not stupid and ignorant.
Right.
Well, I don't think.
They completely.
I don't think necessarily that, and this is when I was watching the movie for this, it's not necessarily that he understands the teenage mind. He understands teenage emotions, which
yeah.
is like
yeah.
all the pressure that your family's putting on you to like
yeah.
be popular or to try and fit in. It seems stupid now, but that was very real and that was very crushing to a lot of people at the time. And he captures that very well.
I can't remember who said this about the movie. It's probably someone involved with the film. But they said, once you get past the acid-wash jeans and the 80s fashion and the big hair, this is pretty much teenagers and how they are nowadays.
If yeah.
you get past a lot of the, you know, the outside
yeah.
external 80s quality of the film. Yeah, it's very, very relatable for teenagers nowadays.
Yeah. And
I mean, even now how people are hating millennials. Like,
mm-hmm.
yeah.
Or,
well, that's just
know,
because we're a bunch of lazy people.
Hate
who,
us as right. We're supposed to be right.
Killing the diamond industry and our yeah. goddamn avocado toast. I mean,
and don't create anything creatively. So subscribe to our Patreon. I don't know how you want to go through this because it's a weird kind of pastiche movie where it's like, effectively, since they're all in detention for 9 hours, time just passes irregularly. Judd Nelson says something, and he's an asshole. It's
fantastic.
He is. He's
a very likable asshole.
Because they're supposed to write an essay, and they don't.
And the thing is, it wasn't that hard. They just, well, how many words did that have to be?
1,000?
1,000.
Okay,
an essay, not the same word, written 1,000 times.
Yeah. Well, like no play. Yeah, but no, like.
He's doing blowout in the
back. Oh, can you imagine Stanley Kubrick's The Breakfast Club?
I want to see that movie.
Molly Ringwald would definitely be menstruating the entire time.
Oh, God.
It's Kubrick,
yeah.
man. I mean, David Fincher, it would be much more phallic.
Yeah.
I'd
say David Lynch would be more. Well, hello there. You talked about menstruation. Well, let me tell you what I think about menstruation. It's an important part of the coming of age of every young lady.
I would love to see his PSA films.
I just want to see a quirky Wes Anderson
work. Oh, my
okay.
goodness.
Oh, my God.
It's all pastel.
Yes.
A lot of the Shins is playing. No,
oh.
the Kinks. It'd be
yeah.
the Kinks, and it would be soft focus.
And it would all take place
oh
in the
50s.
Oh, my goodness. We could try a Shakespeare yeah. one. A Shakespeare one. Yeah, there's several avenues.
Kenneth
you
Branagh's
to.
The Breakfast Club.
Yes.
I say that, John Nelson. You have been quite a douchey. Is it about your father? I think it's about your father. Your father seems to have burned you with that cigar, John Nelson. That's terrible. You're right, it would have been dreadful. Oh, poor Judd Nelson. Do you want to see how I got these scars?
Still don't know how Judd Nelson would never went on to have a career, but whatever.
I know.
Poor guy. Oh, wait, no, I'm sorry. He did Boondock Saints 2. I'm sorry.
Oh no, no, that'd kill anyone.
I'm sorry,
career.
My favorite. Am I allowed to cuss?
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. My favorite scene of Judd Nelson is when he's making fun of Brian. And then he's talking about his home life, and he goes, this is the life of Brian. Hey, son. Yeah, Dad. How'd you like to go fishing this weekend? Gee, Dad. That's great. And he goes, well, what about you? Fuck you. Well, no, Dad. What about you? You're ugly. Leslie. yeah. This shows a cigar.
Yeah.
What about you? Boom. That scene, like, I was just like, okay. It hit me hard.
I
like, I fell in love with you. Oh my God, that scene hit me hard. So good.
Yeah, that's why I love this movie so much. That's why I hate to go into my gripes about it. But I don't know. Do we want to do gripes?
Do it. Do
it,
man.
It does have gripes, sure. All right.
Well, you mentioned earlier that something seemed cartoonish—the not smelling the weed thing. there's one scene that really bothers me in this movie. It's like 2 seconds long, and it's really cartoonish. It's the scene with Emilio Estevez when he screams and the glass breaks. Mm. Why is that in there? It seems so out of place.
Well, and again, what it should have been is a fantasy sequence where he cuts back and the glass is there.
I know that they're all high and they're dancing in the library and it's hilarious, but it's like, why does the glass break? It just seems like a cartoon.
And similarly, half of Judd Nelson's story is that way too, because at one point after being, I don't know, like he's an altar boy to the principal for a second. He's locked in a room and yelled at, and like he's naked and afraid, effectively.
Yeah.
He does a Mission Impossible crawl like he's in a Die Hard movie, for Christ's sake.
Right.
And then he falls through the ceiling.
I'm still wondering what the punchline is to that damn joke.
I know. He says no shit. No shit.
Oh, that's the punchline. Yeah.
That is the punchline. You're welcome.
I thought the punchline was supposed to be forgot my pencil and he just told the wrong joke.
The thing about it is, it's a different movie for 30 seconds.
Right.
I have nothing against the scene, but I like when they go out into their own stories. I just wish they all had that. It seems like it's the Judd Nelson show, but, you know, but Ally Sheedy disappears for half the movie.
And then she comes back, and yeah.
And has four lines.
I needed more of what was going on with Ally Sheedy.
Ally Sheedy needed some more development. And I'm wondering, I don't know, I don't want the Criterion Blu-ray deleted scenes.
The $700 Laserdisc edition.
I have the $5 DVD of it. So like,
there's a scene.
I did too!
There's a scene where they go into the bathroom and Molly Ringwald's putting on lipstick, but she sees Ally Sheedy in the stall and then like randomly opens it and she's just in there eating Doritos.
I was imagining a mild fantasy sequence for her, since they all get them, where she's looking at her drawing and it moves like it's the snowman.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like just little moments where you realize that. I mean,
that would
she's
be very
like,
John Hughes.
Well, and she's effectively like Raven from Teen Titans. Like she's just a secret person who's like in her own world. Give her own world then. Like when they're all listening to that shitty 80s rock most of the time, the generic. No, I mean, it's fine. It's very generic. She should be listening to The Cure or to Prince because.
Mm-hmm.
Although she does hold up a Prince album at one point. But you know, like just give her something that's her own. But
more.
It's almost as though John Hughes is like, yeah, I don't get her. So I'm going to talk about these dudes for a bit.
Also, I looked this up because it was bothering me. Guess what they used for the dandruff?
It was
for her famous dandruff scene.
It was cheese, wasn't it?
How do you? Yes, Parmesan cheese.
I looked it up on IMDb.
You looked it up too? Parmesan cheese.
Nerd.
The whole because that scene always. I was like, oh my god, that was disgusting.
I have to say, all of these characters are very well cast. They all give top-notch performances, especially for a bunch of 16, 17-year-olds.
So let's improve it.
So these characters are so. They just grab your attention and you love them. They're so lovable. So I could honestly watch these characters in a room for 2 or 3 more hours, to be quite honest.
I mean, that's why I say it feels like a bottled drama to me. Because, if there was a sequel, it would just be...
It would be terrible.
Well, it would be, but what it would be was, the homecoming game.
Yeah.
And Judd Nelson doesn't want to be there. And but that's what it is.
What it would be is The Big Chill, which is not a good movie.
Because, again... That's a baby boomer movie for baby boomers. Mm. This is a baby boomer movie written, but it's for Gen Xers. These are people who are distant and disappointed and hate the world. Like that's what Gen X is. They don't believe they're almost nihilistic. And this is what this movie is. There's a bunch of boomers on top of them saying who they should be, and they don't want to be that person.
Yeah.
Etc.
Well, in terms of the characters, though, I thought Bender was way too over the top.
Yeah,
okay,
do you?
That's fair.
Yeah.
Well, it's his show. This is the Bender show.
He's kind of the star of the movie.
Yeah, but I mean, he was just so...
Also never before and never since.
Well, I kind of knew some people like that, though, in high school.
I kind of did
too,
but...
Right?
The Nick,
we've discussed this several times, but Nick and I went to high school together. Yeah. We knew, I knew some people... Right, I knew kind of people like that.
I went to high school with someone who just lost a Super Bowl.
Oh.
Right, anyway.
Oh, Nick went to high school with Saints players.
I went to college with Ben Roethlisberger. He's a dipshit.
But you think it was over the top?
It was like a composite. I mean, the bully figure is obviously a figure that every high school has, but this guy was way too over the top. Like, him... Well, him openly threatening people, him openly being abusive. I mean, that scene where he sticks his face into Molly Ringwald's crotch.
That was weird.
What especially got me was that we're supposed to be sympathetic to this dude when he's been an asshole the entire time.
Well, a lot of the times people use their assholery as a sort of shield to mask
see,
something.
I don't think that's the case, though. I think...
horrible upbringing. Horrible. Life.
Well, I mean, they show the cigar... The cigar, yeah, I remember the cigar burn, but I think that's.
I think
just
it's supposed to be the typical stereotypical bad boy with a heart of gold.
I will.
He's
ask
a bad boy with a heart of gold.
How does he have a
that
heart
a lot of
gold, of
girls
though?
Fall in love with? Because I don't know, he does end up at the end. Yeah, he
I
redeems
will ask
himself.
You, though.
He does redeem himself.
And there was a very interesting point that was brought up that I really enjoyed. It's I think Anthony Michael Hall brings that up. He's like, when we have school on Monday, are we
going right
to talk to
what's
going to
happen, right?
Because I consider you guys my friends.
Yeah.
He's like, yeah, and then they're all like, you know, to be honest, we're probably going to pretend we don't know each other. And that's so heartbreaking.
But, I mean, it's, to your point, or maybe it was Daniel's point, but it's the Wes Anderson bit of this because the song is perfect. Because the last song is Don't You Forget About Me, which
yeah
is the thesis, right?
Right.
Yeah.
Now, as the only, like, lady type on this podcast...
Oh, well, okay, I'll jump in with my
right
phone.
I mean...
Anything you want me to be, I'll be a lady.
Girl. Judd Nelson being an asshole. I mean, we've all dated assholes.
Mm-hmm.
So how does that work for you? Because, I mean, I'm only...
Again, I knew... I'm not going to name names, but I knew people... I knew people like that in high school, so
but
like...
Were you charmed by them? Because they only know each other for 9 hours.
That's kind of like... No. Like, you kind of go through a phase where that's what you want, but you realize it doesn't get anywhere, but yeah.
But I mean, again, like... Because again, this is 9 hours,
mm-hmm,
and so it's effectively like a week of class, 2 weeks of class.
Yeah.
So if day three, I drop a pencil and stick my head in your crotch in the... like... Right? And I mean, you can say he's a charming dude. He's essentially the guy who does the slap shot and there's always a guy like this. And I was thinking of Mighty Ducks, but there's always the tall guy with the shaggy hair.
Well,
I'm
not
going to
name names, but we went to high school with a guy that like would try some stuff like that on me.
On you?
Yeah. So
was it
no,
me?
Do you go? So do you go for that? No, no. You don't.
I mean, and that's the thing I hate. Not
right.
I hate about Molly Ringwald.
Not if you have self-respect. You don't.
Which
go
she
for
doesn't.
That. Right.
And that's.
I think that's the problem.
That's the thing that bothers me. I wish at the end, he was making all these moves, and the last shot of them was that she says no.
Oh, that would have been a cool one.
Because then she also learned something, but yeah, she seems to be the only one who doesn't develop as a character.
Yeah.
I think I completely agree with you.
Because, like, he opens up for the first time. Emilio Estevez admits that he's weak because he's being forced. He doesn't
yeah
want to be this guy. Anthony Michael Hall becomes kind of a cool dude. And Ally Sheedy speaks. Like, her speech. But she's
comes
like,
out of herself.
I just wish some dude would like me. And then he does. After essentially goosing her. I don't know what he does. But she goes, like, she has a mild orgasm.
Makeover, 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 makeover.
That's
no,
weird.
She,
that is weird.
She has the less amount of growth. I agree with you. But Emilio's, that's my favorite scene, is when he's talking about pressure from his dad.
Oh, that works.
When, yeah.
Yeah, that
it
really
completely
works.
I don't know that many teenage movies that came out before this that really discussed the pressures from parents that mm-hmm a lot of teenagers feel.
Zero.
Am I right?
Yeah, no, I'm with you.
Yeah, this is the first movie that kind of dives into the whole, like, my dad just pressures me. I have to impress him and make good grades, and especially Anthony Michael Hall making good grades with the elephant lamp.
Yeah.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that is... No, that
tried to kill himself,
here's
yeah.
Here's another big part of this, though, is that high school doesn't... Well, I mean, did your high school have, like, a three-story library?
No, I mean,
yes.
I will say, it doesn't matter. It seems too big.
Yeah.
That's the thing about this. This is depicted as a high school that is bigger than them, and they're trying to conquer it. I get that, but that's what it is.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I, you might know this better than I do. What's the town that all of this is supposed to be set in?
Shermer.
Illinois.
Shermer. It's where Jay and Silent Bob were
trying three
to
of his
to.
Movies. Where three of John Hughes' other movies are made.
Yeah, like all of John Hughes' movies are around the Chicago area.
Yeah.
Johnny?
Yeah, Johnny. Johnny Hughes.
Johnny Hughes. No, that's adorable. I'm not going to argue with you. I'm just saying, like, you know Ty Perry. You know my buddy Ty.
So Anthony, can we establish that Anthony Michael Hall was, I mean, he admits like he was trying to kill himself.
Yeah.
Okay.
With the flare gun.
Right.
Which oh, by the by.
Which is very relevant today.
They played that off as a joke. A flare gun would have fucking melted that man. That would have been a real fucking thing. Also, he would have been Columbine so hard. Like, cops would have showed up, right?
Well, that's another problem with this movie.
1985?
Well, in 1985, but yet again, when I was watching these, it's like, this is going to be what high school is like. And growing up in a post-Columbine world in a high school, you're exactly right. Somebody like that would have been taken out in handcuffs.
Marty, you got to come back with me. Emilio Estevez is trying to have a career. We've got to stop it.
Oh, Doc.
No,
no.
Oh, jeez.
Well, no, what he does is he meets Martin Sheen's like going, do I turn out okay? Oh, you're fine, Martin. You got a TV show where you play the president. It's your kids, Marty. Your kids. Something has to be done.
We got
to
do something about your kids.
This Cadillac will never get it up to 88 miles an hour. We're never going to get back to the future. We're going to be stuck with Reagan for another 4 years.
Well, you know, where we're going, we don't need roads.
We're defunding them all.
Mommy.
Good Reagan. Oh, fucking hell. All right,
Mommy,
so...
I was told not to use any more pavement by my astrologist.
One more scene I want to mention is please. I really enjoyed the one scene that they gave the principal and the janitor together in the office. I thought that was great because it totally showed you where the principal was coming from on everything and how truly sadistic and evil he is. But it brought a lot of character development. And the janitor was such a nice little side character. I loved him.
Well, and again, it's that one trope as a high schooler, I mean, as someone who teaches, with a kid, there's that one student who thinks that they're like a teacher's out to get them, and here the principal's literally in his permanent records. Yeah, and that's great. And like, literally, the janitor shows up like with a sixer of Molsons or whatever.
And he goes into that whole old man speech where he's like, "These little fuckers are gonna be, you know, like
taking care of us. Yeah,
taking care of us and changing our diapers. They're our future. Yeah. I gotta mold them. I gotta shape them."
Now, this was pretty much the archetype for every Principal Skinner and Groundskeeper Willie scene, so I appreciate it on that.
Well, and again,
yeah, you're right.
And I have nothing against that scene, because it's just, it's so grimy and dark, and the janitor's like, the janitor is the pure character here, because there's no shade to him.
He calls him out on his shit, too.
Yeah, and he calls the students out on their shit.
Well,
by the way, that clock is 5 minutes fast.
Well,
love
here's
that.
Another deleted scene was an extended bit with the janitor where he's like trying to predict what the students would be like when they grow up. And it's like, Ally Sheedy will be a poet, but nobody cares.
Yep.
Emilio Estevez will be like a district sales manager making $22,000 a year, and the stewardess he marries ends up really fat. And it gets pretty bad. I think Molly Ringwald has 2 boob jobs and 3 faceless by the time she's 40. Mm. He gets pretty vicious.
That's crazy. I have to see this Criterion Blu-ray.
I get it because Hughes deserves introspection and he doesn't allow it. He has a dark side, and it's also, and Daniel can go fuck off. I don't care about his opinion here.
Yeah, Daniel.
But. There's also a suburbanness to him. He might be our first suburban director as far as like kind of a ontology goes, right? Because he has a thought of him. Like, as a filmmaker, you want to be where the action is. And so it's always either the city or you have a passive nothingness in urban America. This is a suburban film, right? It's a very white film because that's what the suburbs were in the 80s and 90s. There's not intensity. All the pressure comes from externally because as suburbanites, we pressure our kids to be better than ourselves, but we've made this world to fail. And that's what this movie's very interesting as, because it's a world where the kids are designed to fail, so let's look at how that failure is going
to
take place.
Now, why exactly did I need to fuck off about your discussions regarding suburbia?
Because I'm a film person, and I know what your opinions are on film people. Okay. I've read your reviews.
You're pressured into agreeing with him.
Okay, well, I mean, I agree with you. You're exactly right. He is a very suburban director, and he was like the first real suburban director that we've ever had.
And it's interesting. It's interesting because even classics that we've even mentioned in this movie, like Kubrick, they pick extremity, like ruralness or urbanness. And he's just like, no. We're a suburban population now, and as suburbanites, as people who are, I'm living now in the biggest suburb in the country, in an Atlanta suburb, everyone's setting up their kids to fail and expecting them to fail and putting pressure on those people.
Well, a lot of 90s indie filmmakers definitely took that suburban mentality. I mean, look at Clerks.
Yeah. I mean, and Kevin Smith is the talky-talk version of... I mean, it's all talky-talky-talk.
I love Clerks. I like Kevin Smith more than most people.
No, I'm with you.
Yeah. I love Kevin Smith. He's so good with dialogue.
But how is Tusk?
I think that's what I'm learning is I'm obsessed with dialogue. That's why I love John Hughes. That's why I love Quentin Tarantino. Mm. That's why I love
Tarantino, Smith, Kevin Smith, Hughes, all great.
Aaron Sorkin.
Those are it's my style.
And it's funny because the second you can see parody, it's sad. I mean, like, I love Scream, but people ripping off Scream because it's all the talky-talk.
Yep.
Talky-talky-talky-talky-talk.
Yeah, every horror movie that came out after Scream tried to be Scream.
Because we wanted to be talky-talk. And Kevin Smith, especially in his first five
films.
And meta,
yeah.
Now, what about all the high school sex comedies that came out in the 90s, like American Pie and Cruel Intentions?
Well, they're written by people who didn't have sex in high school.
That's kind of true. It's kind of true. Although American Pie is kind of an exception because it's one of the few sex raunch comedies that had likable characters with heart that you...
I like American Pie.
Mom.
Well, the thing is, like, most of the teen sex comedies that came out were throwaway two-dimensional characters, but American Pie actually had characters.
I think Cruel Intentions had characters. They were just terrible characters.
Cruel Intentions is a good one.
I have not seen it.
No.
Oh.
You've never seen Cruel Intentions?
Okay, let's soften it a little bit.
Watch it with Alyssa. Thank me later. Okay?
Okay. I think she mentioned it.
Mm-hmm. Someone might get a hoe.
Yeah.
Oh, boy. Anyway. That's going to be a fun night.
I was thinking Mean Girls, too.
Yeah.
We have this era of filmmaking, which, again, nothing against John Hughes, because I don't like all of his movies 100%, but when you create a genre, you don't hit it out of the park every time, because you have to feel out what that genre is. And I think this movie might be, well, we'll get to Final Judgments in a minute, but I think this might be his best movie. It's not the one I rewatch the most, but it might be his best.
I totally agree that it's like one of the quintessential films of the 80s, and it's probably in the top five, if not the top most important and iconic teenage film of all time. But I enjoy watching 16 Candles or Ferris Bueller's Day Off more so than Breakfast Club. But Breakfast Club, I guess, in terms of quality, it's probably the better film.
What about Not Another Teen Movie, which has teen in the title?
It has also Principal Vernon.
Parody that parodies Breakfast Club that brings back the principal, and he returns to form. He's so great.
I mean, here's the thing about the external movies about this. This movie should have just stayed that bottle movie, right? Because, again, it's the idea that they're trapped in one space, and we didn't even talk about the whole movie, but at one point they break out because the principal's taking a shit or something. And they're just traipsing down the hall. And again, it becomes almost a musical number. It becomes a Scooby-Doo scene where they're just like running around.
That was full on Scooby-Doo when they were running always. There's some great moments of comedic levity in this film. Some cartoonish moments.
I mean, I will say it's a rare picture that we've talked about that our audience has to have seen, right? Like, everyone has seen this movie.
Yeah.
So for us, this is just a reassessment. And as a reassessment, it's kind of a masterwork of filmmaking.
Yeah.
If only the values had aged as well as the rest of it, because there's some stuff that just would not work as well today.
No,
I completely disagree with you. Oh, okay. So much love. I completely disagree.
I think so many aspects of this film are timeless.
Yeah, I'll talk about my final thoughts, but
yeah.
No, I mean, we can do final thoughts here in a second. I'm going to both agree and disagree with Daniel, because I agree they're weird. It's just that since it's the 80s, everyone looks like they're in their
20s. Some of them are actually 16, though.
Well, only two. It's Anthony yes, Michael but Hall and thanks, Molly Ringwald.
Yeah,
thanks to a magical drug called cocaine, I think some of them look older than they actually are.
Okay, Judd Nelson did look like college, at least.
I'm going to be a captain! Okay, here's the thing. I think the movie... Well, let's do final judgments. Adam.
Okay. Like I said earlier, it is one of the quintessential movies of the 80s. You cannot talk about the teenage film genre without bringing up Breakfast Club. It's been parodied multiple times. I'd say a lot of kids nowadays have probably seen it. But I love this movie. I have gripes with it. I think it can get a little melodramatic at parts. I think there are a few cartoonish moments that seem out of place. But I love this movie. I've seen it countless times. I think it's great. It's got lovable characters. It's well cast. Some of the best young performances you'll ever see on film. I think it's great. I love it. It's a classic. It's a classic. You can't knock it too much.
Yep. Danny.
All right. So this isn't my favorite John Hughes movie. That's Planes, Trains, and Automobiles. It isn't my favorite high school movie. That's Heathers.
Good.
It's a good one.
That is a good one. But even watching it today, there were times where I was like, this is just so schmaltzy and these kids are so melodramatic. But then at a certain point, it made me regress to how I felt in high school about all these things. And I'm like, this is actually capturing it really well. All these minor seeming things that I look back now and laugh at, that's how I felt about him. I felt like I had to succeed here because this would be the most important thing in my life. And this movie captures that very well, and it does so very effectively with a small cast, a small budget, and some actors who at the time really weren't all that well known. True. So good for him. I mean, he kind of kickstarted the independent film revolution a couple years earlier than everybody says. So yay for you, John Hughes. Yep.
Yeah. One more thing I'll say is I think the movie has aged fairly well in most aspects. And there are a lot of things that are timeless about it. But there's a line that really resonated with me watching the film. It was, oh my God, are we going to become like our parents?
Yeah.
It's so true. And then when you, when now that I'm 26 years old, 10 years after I saw the movie, I'm like, yeah, we're going to become like our parents.
Pretty much.
Lauren?
I don't know. This is my movie. I don't know. There's something about it that speaks to me, that speaks to my soul. I don't know. I'm just a total John Hughes. I love the dialogue. I think it's amazing casting. I think it's amazing acting. I think it captures kind of what high school is really like. And not that I had a horrible high school experience, but I definitely didn't have the best. You know, it was definitely rough at times. And I think it just captures that really well. And there's something about it. I would watch this with my sister and my family and just all the time. It was because it was on TBS all the time. But there's just something about it that I love and will always have a special place in my heart. And it's just my movie and I will watch it forever whenever it's on. But I think it does kind of resonate with modern day, because I think what this main movie teaches is that everyone has struggles. Mm-hmm. Everyone has problems. Everyone suffers. You don't know what people are going through. You have no idea what the person next to you is going through. So just be kind. Just be loving, just be gentle, because you don't know, and just be loving, and that's mainly what it teaches me, and also always be yourself, and don't change for others, don't try to be who you're not, just because of pressure from your parents, or friends, or like, whatever, just always be yourself, and just, I don't know, just always be kind, because you don't know what people are going through.
Yeah. She feels that in the depth of the library, her soul is being touched by these teenagers.
Every teenager should watch John Hughes' movies.
I agree.
Period. Long live John Hughes.
It is like a window.
And I did a whole paper because Nick and I were in a film class together, and this was one of my top five. Yeah, this is one of my top five.
Lauren, that was a fantastic.
Yeah. I'm just saying.
You're so right about
good.
It.
Sorry, was I being melodramatic? Like,
no.
Molly?
I just
Molly?
Couldn't help but her song right there.
My brain rebooted like halfway through because it was very good. I'm picking on this movie because that's the nature of the podcast. And, you know, after Scott last week, who sent hackers to us, I feel bad if we just, you know, made out with this movie for 20 minutes. But I like this film because it talks like a person that I know. Right. Mm-hmm. Like and that's kind of the problem with it, too, because maybe it's that when dudes pick their favorite film, there's something hyper masculine about them. You know, it's not that I didn't want to be I mean, Scarface is garbage. I was thinking like being in Bond, you know, like I was thinking like there's something, not that I want to be a hypersexual person, but there's something about being put together. This movie is about being naked.
Yeah, there's and that, so much vulnerability in this.
Yeah, for sure.
And the problem is everyone's putting on a different facade.
Yeah.
That's what I like about it. Mm-hmm. You know, I had girlfriends in high school that Lauren didn't approve of. But that doesn't matter. The thing is you're putting on an act to get them. That's what this movie is. It's about getting in, like putting on an act. I like, though, that Anthony Michael Hall doesn't end up with, you know, Ally Sheedy. Because that's not the movie that they're putting together. They're putting together a movie that's broken because high school is broken. I just wish this world existed for longer in some ways. This movie is a perfect capsule. It's a bottle movie, right? Like, this would be in the episode in Star Trek where everyone's stuck in the holodeck, right? Like, mm-hmm. that's what this is.
Yeah.
But they don't try to answer the question of what happens on Monday. They pretend like they do, but I've also been with groups of people who pretend like they like me. I was once to a Sadie Hawkins dance with a girl because oh, please. Her name was Katie. And they were like, hey, you're someone who has a penis. You want to go to the dance with her? It happened. It
you
wasn't
to go
great.
To a dance with a girl in high school? I'm so envious.
Oh my God, that's like the most amazing thing I've ever heard.
I was kind of intimate with someone in a girl's basement
Dude,
once.
I was at home
when Lauren didn't approve.
Uh-oh. Meanwhile, I'm sitting at home in my own basement.
I have a judgy
basement.
Friend here.
I'm not judgy.
No, in a good way.
I'm not judgy.
No.
I'm envious.
We love each other. That's why we're friends.
I just look out for you.
I looked out for you too.
Yes.
Now we're married Aww. To people we both approve of. And Scott got me drunk. Nah, anyway, we'll wrap this up. So, you know what? Here's the thing. We've got some friends. We've got some listener requests. We've got some other movies coming up. Next week, when you listen in, we're going to be playing Inspector Gadget, starring another classic person from John Hughes.
Oh, my God.
Matthew Broderick.
Still trying so hard to pretend like he mattered in the 90s.
And didn't kill a guy in Ireland.
Hey, Godzilla.
Which was the previous episode, so stay tuned.
Right. We're going to produce.
Election
is fantastic.
It is fantastic.
One of Matthew Broderick's few good movies, along with The Producer.
Nick, thank you for doing this movie.
Well, to Warren, thanks for
Warren.
Calling this in.
Warren,
yes, thank you, Warren.
We got to buy this guy a stout.
And stay tuned next week and every future week when we make you a producer. Thanks, guys.
Myopia Defending Childhood is produced by Do Better Podcasting and a member of the ESO Network. It is hosted by Nick Hoffman, edited by Daniel Fettis and Ann Burr. It is produced by Daniel Fettis, Matthew Quinn, and Ann Burr. Thomas Herman is our consultant. Nick Hoffman is our executive producer. The theme song is Surf Shimmy by Kevin MacLeod. Find it at incompetech.com. It is licensed under the Creative Commons license. Thanks. That we were working on. Slow change may pull us apart. When a life gets in your heart, baby, don't you forget about me. This has been a broadcast of the ESO Network. Be part of the crew and help support our shows by donating to our ESO Patreon or by shopping through Amazon.com or the TeePublic store, which can all be found at www.esonetwork.com. The ESO Network, your station for all things geek.